Yeah, hello. After a long day of like lots of technical talks, breath of fresh air, no technical stuff here, okay? Just I'll give you an intro about me first. I'm Navin. I work at Bloomreach. I work as a full stack dev there. I graduated from IIIT Bangalore. Fun fact, if you move to the banquet hall downstairs right now, my senior is presenting there, also from IIIT Bangalore. You can't get away from IIIT Bangalore for the next half an hour. Yeah, I think everything else speaks for itself. Anyone who's tweeting out to me questions right now, later, love it, hate it, Navin Pai is why you can do it. I see people walking in, so like I'll just give you an overview of why you should be interested, if you should be. This is what we're going to be talking about over the next 20 minutes or so, 15 minutes, 20 minutes or so. We're going to be talking about Super Mario Brothers, obviously, Saving the Princess, obviously. We'll talk about reinforcement learning, and we had a really cool talk this morning, the first talk that happened. So, show of hands, how many people are here for the talk this morning by Vikas? Awesome, that's really cool because that means that I don't have to go through a lot of the base setup that Vikas went through. I can jump straight into it. We'll talk about Q-learning, we'll talk about DPU networks. This is going to be extremely light on math and it's going to be a practical deep learning problem that we're going to solve over the next 20 minutes. And before I get into it, because there are a couple of hardcore researchers here, this is extremely derivative work. No original research here. Anyone expecting original research, please walk out. So, obviously it's this paper. I think anyone who says DPU networks will definitely point to this paper. People who have not read this paper, leave this talk, go and read that paper. It's an amazing paper which kind of laid the foundation for work that's happening right now over the last 3 years. The second talk that we had today spoke about GANs and how 2016 and 2017 have been the year of the GAN. People have just been talking about GANs throughout. Whereas I think 2015, 2016 has been the year of reinforcement learning to a large extent. So we had lots of improvements over what I'm going to be talking about, and we'll talk about that as we go along as well. So obviously the first question that comes up when we're talking about deep Q networks or saving the princess is, what exactly is Q learning? So for Q learning, all I can say is it's a type of reinforcement learning. So people who attended the talk in the morning know what it means, right? Okay, maybe not. So I'll just do a brief through it. It's reinforcement learning is basically how we grow up, right? When we grow up as kids, say you get an A in an exam, then what do you get? You get a reward for it, and you get an F, and you get a timeout. Now, this seems like a very simple process that when you do something good, you get rewarded for it. When you do something bad, you get punished for it. But it's not always that simple. Like for example, if you get an A in an exam, but then you dirty your room, you might still be scolded for it. But, and it might, as a child, you might think that because I got an A in an exam, I'm getting scolded for it. And that's gonna end up having students like this, who are extremely bad students because we never really understood that getting an A is important. Whereas the opposite also works, where you might get an F, but you clean your room and you get rewarded for it, and you end up in the same vicious cycle. So this question is called the problem of credit assignment, where what we try to do is, we take a set of actions and then we try to give the reward to the action that is responsible for it. So what exactly is Q-learning? Q-learning basically answers this question, which most reinforcement learning answers. The question is, do we explore or do we exploit? Now what does explore means? Explore is simple, just take the action and do it and see what happens. Whereas exploit means try to go for a reward. So reinforcement learning as a whole tries to answer this question, and there's always a question of when should we explore, when should you exploit, how much should you explore, how much should you exploit, and so on and so forth. And there's a whole set of papers that you can read on this very question. A couple of links are listed on below which answer these as well. But we'll get directly to Q learning. The most important part of Q learning breaks this problem down into a function which is called the Q function, hence the name Q learning. So what it says is that Q of a state and an action is equal to R of a state and action plus gamma max of Q next state and all actions. To break it down into simple English, all that it says is, for a given state, the Q function for a given action is equal to the reward that you get for performing that action on the state plus some factor gamma into max of the Q of the next state, all actions that can be performed at that next state. So that means that if I can move here, it's going to be the reward that I get for coming here plus all the maximum of the reward of all the moves that I can do from this point onwards. Now obviously gamma is a very interesting thing, because what does gamma do? Let's say gamma is 0. In that case, all that you get is Q state action is R state action. That means that I'll just go for the immediate reward at every point of time. Whereas let's say gamma is a larger number, in that case the other term dominates and we try to become more far-sighted in our vision with our algorithm. I think this is what Vikas also spoke about this morning, where you have myopic vision and you have like far-sighted vision. So it's all about playing around with this gamma in order to figure out when to exploit, should I go for a reward right now, should I wait for a reward sometime down the line, or how exactly I should tackle these problems. So I wanted to do a Q-learn. Q-learning started off long ago, as with most artificial neural network algorithms. It started off long ago with simple tabulation, which is DP style. So what you have is, in this case, I have a simple graph where your start position is 2 and your end position is 5, for example. And all I need to do is figure out a way to go from 2 to 5. So if I'm at 2, I just have one path possible, that is to go to 3. So I try that path, then from 3 I have 2 paths possible, let's say I come to 4. From 4 I have 2 paths possible, I can go to 0 or I can go to 5, and I just try a lot of these variations over time while I maintain a table that stores the Q value that I compute over iterations. Over time, once I've explored enough, I'll actually get a table that's something like this. So you see that the Q values are listed over each of the graph paths that we see here. So from 2, the max Q value is 64, so we come to 3. From 3, you can either go to 4 or you can go to 1, which is 80. So let's just randomly pick 1. From 1, you have 2 paths, you can come back to 3, which is the 64 there, or you can go to 5, so you pick the max again, and the max Q value, and you end up with 80, you end up in your goal state. So that's simply how Q learning works. For obvious reasons, this is not very efficient, because if you have many states and you have many actions, that table is gonna just keep getting huger. So in comes DeepMind and other papers that came up last year, which came a couple of years back, which actually spoke about how that Q function itself can be a neural network instead of actually being a tabular method like this. So this is basically their definition that they use. They say, instead of having the previous Q function that I had, why not have a neural network that approximates the value that Q has? And because it is modeled in such a way, what I can do is I can simply look at this as a loss function, because you see the term on the left has to approximate the term on the right. So take this on the other side and then use mean squared or some other form of simple reinforcement learning, simple error function in order to, as a loss function, and then minimize it. So this is basically what deep Q networks do. They take the simple Q learning paradigm, add a neural network into the mixture in order to approximate the Q network, and then continue on as per. Next up, the interesting part of the talk. Super Mario Brothers. How many people here play Super Mario? If you all didn't raise your hand, I'd be super amazed. So Super Mario came out in 1983, amazingly, which I still find amazing because it makes me feel super old. And it basically took the world by storm. The reason this game is very interesting to me personally is because I played this literally since I was, I think, 4 years old. And saving the princess was my life's motto. And from a computer science perspective, the reason I find it interesting is because the game space, even though it's constrained, it is pretty large. And you have a lot of delayed rewards. And I'll talk about this a little more later. Also, you have multiple game characters and there's a lot going on the screen per se. So when the paper came out of DPU Network, the main thing that they played was Pong. And that was the main paper, main game that they played. But what I realized is Mario also is very similar in the sense that it is constrained yet a much more open world. Hence, I thought, why not use this algorithm to play Super Mario Brothers? So first things first, we need to look at Super Mario Brothers, a deep Q network problem. How do we do that? For obvious reasons, Mario is going to be our agent, who's going to be performing the actions. The action can be one of the possible actions that you can play in the game. That's left, right, up, down, shoot, blah, blah, blah. The state is the current state of the game. For this very algorithm, the state is actually n consecutive frames of data together. The reason for this is very simple. If you look at Mario right now, what do you think the action should be? Should he jump or should he just stand there? Anyone? It's not really that obvious that he should jump, because what if both the Goombas are going the other direction? Right? Because with a single frame, you cannot really talk about what exactly is the action. Are the Goombas coming towards you or are they going away from you? So as such, because you want to have that temporal nature of the thing, we actually use three to four separate frames, and I've used 4 for my example. The score is what's the reward that we want to maximize, and the end goal is to have a Q function that approximates that. And the environment is obviously Mario interacting with everything. Just to make it clear once more, when we play this game, we do not tell Mario anything. We do not tell him that if you touch a Goomba, you die. We do not tell him if you fall in a hole, you die. We do not tell you take a mushroom, you get a life up. We do not tell him anything at all. And it's over time that Mario himself learns to play the game. So this is a neural network that I used for this. this is very, very, very similar to the one that was published in the original paper that came out in 2013 and was published in the Nature journal in 2015. So it's 484 by 84 images, which are grayscaled actually, which cannot be seen there, which are then goes through a whole set of neural networks. It's just a slightly larger neural net compared to what they had in the original paper to take into account for the more complex nature of the Mario game. And then we have a fully connected layer along with 12 possible outputs. Now, 12 possible outputs, why do we need 12 possible outputs? There's only left, right, up, down. There's also the B button, which is to run faster, like pros of the game. To run faster, you can hold B and go right or left, to jump higher as well. So you have those combinations as well that are taken care of, and obviously there are no operations, that is do nothing. So all those together comes up to 12 outputs. So now let's do this. What exactly do we do to do this? So first off, maximum reuse. The main purpose of doing this talk is to let people who have like not really dabbled too much into neural networks know that it's super easy to get started. For this, the base that I used was entirely the DQN code. It's written in Torch. It's pretty nicely written code. You can actually read through it to some extent. There's a talk coming on PyTorch as well, so I'm looking forward to that to see if I can port it to that. So mainly, a lot of stuff has been reused directly from their code itself for this. Handling custom bindings and combo moves. Now again, because Nintendo has its own custom moves and combo bindings, like I mentioned previously, we actually make sure that we have different bindings that are separate outputs. We don't have B as one output and left as one output. We have B plus left as an output and B plus right as an output and left as an output and right as an output. So at any one point, we'll just be getting one, which is a major output, and that'll be either B left, B right, up, down, left, right, so on and so forth. Experience replay. Experience replay is actually kind of the core of the deep neural network algorithm. So what this basically does is it tries to break the temporal nature of experiences. So if I go ahead at one point and then I jump in the next move, we want to make sure that the jumping is not affected by the going ahead. We don't want every time the jump to be go ahead and jump, for example, unless that's actually required. So what experience replay does is it stores these tuples, which are the state, the action, the next state and the reward in memory. And it randomly picks up those experiences when it tries stuff out. Then we have experimentation. And this is where a lot of time went, because the games that they played was actually played on an Atari learning environment, which is a very, very nicely fledged, full-fledged environment to play games. And everything that done had been tuned for those games. So with this, it ended up being a little more complex, because first of all, finding a Nintendo emulator itself that works decently well is difficult. So I used ESNES at first, then shifted to FCU and stuff like that. And along with that, also playing around in learning rates, figuring out what exactly works, what does not work, stuff like that. And finally, we train our model. So for training our model was super simple. I just had the lamest machine out there, which is a G2 AWS instance, which I used for training. And it actually trained for, I think, around a week with me checking in the initial days to see what's going on with it. And yeah, again, a couple of links down there for everything. And I think we'll head to the demo. You can sing along the Mario track if you want to. Yeah, so this is actually, I think, a little sped up. So you see Mario, again, just to stress again, Mario has never told what an environment is, what is. I like the cheeky thing that it did there, where it moved ahead a couple of steps and then jumped. It kills a couple of Goombas. And it finishes the level as well. And now it gets into the underworld level, which people have played, I'm pretty sure. It does get stuck here for a while, and I'll talk a little more about why I feel this happens for multiple this. If we just give it 10 more seconds, and hopefully it does move. And so that's it. So it like managed to get through the first level, would not really do too well in the second one. Okay, so I'll come to the hurdles that I faced, and like we'll talk about a couple of problems that we saw in the video as well. The first one, delayed rewards everywhere. I think this is something that intuitively human beings understand very clearly when you play Mario. What's the first thing you do when you start Mario is you take the mushroom right at the start, right? But why do we take that mushroom? Because we realize that down the line, if somewhere you die, then not having that mushroom ends the game, whereas having the mushroom makes you continue the game, allows you to continue the game. But that can come much, much, much later in the game. So because of that delayed reward, it's it's super difficult to like actually get the credit assignment set for this. The second part of it, Mario refuses to move. So this is a bit of cheating that I did. Like initially, if you notice, if you play the game, then initially Mario, even if it moves, the score does not change at all. And it takes a certain level of movement in order for the score to increase or decrease. So that's why there was a slight bias that I added right at the start to get it to move to the right. Over time, that bias has reduced, but there was a slight bias there to move to the right at the start. The second bit was tracking progress. Tracking progress in a game like this is difficult because of the explore and exploit nature of this entire thing. You know that it's going to be zigzagging up and down. So there'd be times when after a day of training, I check it's made certain progress, but after 3 days, it seems to be at the same level or just slightly better, whereas like 3 hours more and suddenly performing better. So I kept track of the average Q value that it was generating and the average Q function. So that actually helped quite a bit. And finally, to answer the question that came in the previous demo as well, is this overfitting? And I think to some extent, yes, it is overfitting. Because overworld training does not generalize too well to underworld, and most of this training has happened on the overworld level. Whereas when you play on another overworld level, it seems to do much, much better. It doesn't just go and die at the first opportunity that it gets, or the first one, the first early opportunity that it gets. So as such, overworld to overworld test is much better, but overworld training to underworld is pretty bad as well, sir. So talking to associated work, there's like Mario, which is Super Mario Brothers using genetic algorithms, which was a nice approach, which is kind of the inspiration for this by this guy named Seth Bling. Deep learning Flappy Bird. Now Flappy Bird again is way simpler as a game for reinforcement learning because it's just up, down, and you can actually play pretty well. CNN 2048 was playing 2048 with a CNN, and just at lunch I had someone tell me that someone has actually done Super Mario as well with a similar approach to mine. So I'll have to check that out, but I've not added that here. Now talking about further work on this, right? Since the DQN paper came out, obviously multiple research papers have come published on the same topic. So like these are a couple of improvements that they have listed out. The first one is a double DQN, where you have one network choosing the action, while the other generates a target queue for it. Then there's a dualing DQN, where we have two networks, where we break the queue function into two actual values that we join together at the last moment, which is the advantage and the value. The advantage is the advantage of doing an action over all other actions, and the value is of staying in the value of the state that is. And finally, prioritized experience replay. Now, when I spoke about experience replay, I said like we store the S, A, the state, action, reward, and next state in memory, and then we just randomly pick out of them. But we know for a fact from human behavior that there are certain experiences that we learn way more from than others, right? So prioritized experience replay actually does that. What it does is it like ranks experiences in a certain order and then picks up from the top instead of picking up from any random place. So as such, it's much better and it trains much better and it gives better results as well. And with that, I'm up with my talk. So your question is over. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much. That's probably one of the most entertaining talks we've had here. It is time for a break, coffee, tea, and feedback forms, please. We'll be back here at 4:30 for our last talk of the day.